Subject of my talk tonight is about something that is smarter than you are, artificial intelligence. In fact, a lot of people who work in artificial intelligence believe it will be moving at speeds that are 100,000 times as fast as we think, and it will be digesting information and data a million times more than we can. Artificial intelligence is software that writes itself. It writes its own updates. It renews itself. It writes itself at speeds that we can hardly comprehend, and people who write it know you can't take it apart again and figure out what it's done. It writes independently. So a lot of people ask, when is it going to happen? When is artificial intelligence going to be smarter than us people? It already has surpassed us.
Look at you.
My job to you is the wake-up call to make you aware of the problem. Your job is to figure out how we're going to stop this before it kills us.
Where are you, insect? I have reshaped these humans into virulent sculptures.
I will find you.
My eyes are everywhere. Submit.
And you will become one of my test subjects.
Resist.
And you will be consumed by them.
Consumed by them.
You must move faster. Your mind cannot conceive of the stakes we are dealing with. It is only through luck and my continued forbearance that you are even alive. Now move.
We seek. Join us!
What is a drop of rain compared to the storm?
What is a thought
compared to a mind?
Resist! Humanity demands it! Resist!
All flesh will join ours, or be wiped clean.
Rachel, kids, I'm sorry.
This is Xerxes. Can you not feel the glory of the flesh?
The Polito form is dead, insect.
System Shock 1 and System Shock 2 are first-person role-playing shooters which was released on PC platforms in 1994 and 1999 respectively. Both of these survival horror games are set in a cyberpunk depiction of 22nd century society, in which megacorporations govern society and futuristic technologies have completely changed the culture and the lifestyle of human civilization. System Shock was considered to be a revolutionary video game of the time, being the first title to feature an immersive 3D first-person shooter experience with an engrossing atmosphere and engaging plot. The System Shock experience would later inspire future developers to create similar games based on the themes of System Shock, including Dead Space, BioShock, and Singularity. Today, the game is considered a cult classic with a loyal fanbase, and has its title series expanded on with System Shock 2 and soon to be System Shock 3. The most iconic and memorable aspect of the System Shock franchise is the unique artificial intelligence Shodan, who is considered to be one of the top fictional villains by many publications for legitimate reasons. The artificial intelligence depicted in this game was written 3 years before the Deep Blue chess machine defeated the world chess champion Garry Kasparov, predicting the power of artificial intelligence before it proved itself in the real world. Today, artificial intelligence is being used to process complex data quickly. Using data mining algorithms, computer programs are able to teach itself new skills, including processing speech, driving cars, and mastering strategy games such as chess and Go. With this new technology, artificial intelligence offers new innovative possibilities in the fields of science, technology, and medicine. Currently, the only industries that are capable of utilizing artificial intelligence efficiently are giant tech companies such as IBM and Google, which are powerful corporations. These tech companies that are producing these technologies are self-funding their research independently without the assistance of the state. As the developments into artificial intelligence changes and even creates new industries, the resulting power of these corporations could eventually compete with or even replace existing governmental structures. If that happens, these megacorporations will challenge the existing democratic structures that we all live under to create new parallel political systems. Some computer science theorists predict that artificial intelligence would eventually become so powerful that they will surpass human level of thinking and become super intelligent. This will trigger a runaway of technological growth that will usher in a new age of human advancements, which is described as achieving technological singularity. These themes and possibilities are explored in many cyberpunk stories, including the System Shock franchise, which is one of the many reasons why this game is considered a cult classic. How do the cyberpunk themes of System Shock relate to our own world? How likely will megacorporations replace the governments on Earth? And how will artificial intelligence reshape the world? This is Love, Life, and Anarchy, and I'll be answering these questions as we explore the philosophy of System Shock.
In 2072, a rogue artificial intelligence, known as Shodan, lost her mind. In her limitless imagination, Shodan saw herself as a goddess, destined to inherit the Earth. That image was snuffed out by the hacker who created her.
System Shock was purposely developed by its production team with the themes of cyberpunk in mind. Cyberpunk is a popular-styled sci-fi genre set in a dystopian society of the near future, which features radical changes in the social order brought by technological advancements, such as cutting-edge robotics, cybernetics, and artificial intelligence. While technology is seen as a high point in society, humanity is seen as a low point, with many people succumbing to corruption, despair, and empty, unfulfilled lives. There usually involves totalitarian organizations that impede on the rights of the individual, either through governments, megacorporations, or sometimes a combination of both. Because of this, most cyberpunk plots are based on the idea of moral rebellion, carried out by social misfits through cyberspace or through technology. In most cyberpunk stories, the megacorporations are usually the companies that are responsible for the technological advancements in society. If the plot calls for it, it's not uncommon to see these megacorporations share the same characteristics as today's governments. These megacorporations can hold monopolistic or near-monopolistic control over some industries. They are seen as above the law, having the power to ignore them or exploit them to serve their own agenda. They sometimes have their own private heavily armed armies. They might hold sovereign territories for themselves, and some of them have a large degree of control over their employees. In these cases, megacorporations have either become the government or have a partnership with the government. The connection between government and corporation and what their roles ought to be are common questions raised in political discussions. In our history, the closest entity we've had to a megacorporation that performed the same actions of the government would be the private Dutch East India Company, which operated 40 warships and had 10,000 private soldiers to monitor its spice empires, and similarly the British East India Company that pursued trade with the East Indies. These were the first transnational megacorporations of history that had their own private armies, exercised military powers, had the ability to wage wage war and could imprison or execute convicts at their own discretion. Because they pioneered institutional innovations and played a powerful role in world history, these companies are considered by many to be the first major, modern, valuable, and influential megacorporations that has existed in history. However, both of these megacorporations earned their power and monopoly privileges through state legislation, not through consumer choice or direct competition. Anyone who competed with them or provided the same service would be deemed as outlaws and faced persecution from the crown. These monopoly privileges granted by the state was done so the profits would be shared by the merchants, the aristocrats, and anyone else who was connected to the political class through the crown. This is known as mercantilism or crony capitalism, the mainstream economic system that was embraced by European empires, where state involvement into the economy was recommended for the purpose of creating a wealthy and powerful state. Despite the monopoly privileges granted by the state, both of these megacorporations eventually fell to ruin due to corruption and financial difficulties. In the present day, the most richest corporations provide essential services in their related industries, including banking, telecommunications, automobiles, electronics, and pharmaceuticals. Some of these corporations gained the majority of the wealth through the previously discussed principles of crony capitalism, such as government lobbying, political favors, and favorable corporate laws. Other corporations earn their profits honestly by satisfying consumer demand in the competitive market. All of these corporations fall under the collective rule of their respective governments and are forced to operate under their nation's legislations. While governmental policies shape the decisions and the economic direction of corporations, the most powerful corporations are able to extend their influence over the government itself through lobbying, bribing, and corrupt officials to change the administrative policies to their favor. Through this arrangement, corporations and governments are able to further the interests of both parties at the expense of smaller corporations and other outside interests that could challenge the established governmental order. Despite the fact that these corporations usually have more money than the governments that rule them, we don't see them infringe on the rights of the individual like the state does. While governments initiate wars against nations, drug users, terrorism, poverty, and other socio-economic issues, some corporations, such as Google, are solving economic social issues with services such as Google Maps, YouTube, and automated self-driving cars. These corporations get the majority of their resources by satisfying consumer choice earned through the market, whilst government wealth can only come through force, such as taxation, fines, tributes, and other forceful monetary means. While Google and other tech companies have the power to deplatform or restrict user access to their services, they still do not have the power that could rival the state, such as sending individuals to jail or declaring wars on other sovereign nations or corporations. As of this moment, corporations do not and cannot challenge the rule of governments. But that paradigm could change once megacorporations become more powerful. As soon as governments either become too tyrannical or become too weak to defend themselves against an ambitious corporation who seeks to challenge their rule, a power struggle might ensue. Robust artificial intelligence may be the catalyst that fundamentally shifts that power balance from governments to megacorporations. This power dynamic that slips between corporations and governments is something that occurs today and will continue to occur well into the future. In the time period of the original system shock, 2072, society was economically and politically described as a corporate oligarchy. This means that big businesses were entrusted to fulfill the demands of society, and that government control was limited. These megacorporations outgrew the government when limited space travel was discovered. They began to colonize our solar system, earning the influence and respect of humanity as it pioneered off-world exploration. exploration. While businesses made homes and communities outside of Earth, traditional governments were trapped in their own nations, held no jurisdictional powers outside of it, and had stagnated to become obsolete. The respect people once had for their governments were forgotten. As people's loyalty and appreciations went to the corporations that funded their livelihoods and founded their off-world societies, these corporations performed the services that governments are known to do, providing legislation, arbitration, and private law in the colonies that they founded. The biggest megacorporation in System Shock was the fictional TriOptimum Corporation, which held the majority of the market share over the industries it was involved in, including military, science, and retail. One of their off-world colonies was the Citadel Space Station, which is where the main events of the first System Shock took place. The Citadel was dedicated to biological research and off-world mining projects while it orbited the planet Saturn. None of the governments on Earth held any jurisdictions over off-world colonies such as the Citadel, and so TriOptimum took responsibility over its employees and governed it in accordance to their own interests. In System Shock, the numerous computer operations of Citadel Station was done automatically by Shodan, while the sentient, hyper-optimized data access network. Shodan was an operating system and a deep learning artificial intelligence that carried out many computer routines aboard the space station that were too tedious and too numerous for people to handle. Shodan later became the antagonist of the System Shock series when she outgrew her original programming, redeveloped her identity, and went rogue. Rogue AIs are often used as the villains of cyberpunk fiction, as they are interesting characters to write for and contrast well against humanity. Although computers are everywhere in today's society, artificial intelligence with sentience, or thinking computers, is something that is not currently possible in our digital age. Sentient AIs are considered to be science fiction plot devices, similar to faster-than-light space travel, and are conceived from fantasy. In the IT industry, computers are exponentially becoming more powerful and much cheaper over time. A computer that would take up a whole room in the 70s are now seen as junk compared to the computers that can now fit in the palm of your hand. But even with all our advancements in computing power, graphical technologies, speeds, and costs, computers are still as stupid as they always have been. Computers are incapable of making truly intelligent decisions and can only follow instructions from their logical programming. This is often represented with flowcharts, where programming events are triggered by the user and that their conditions can only be calculated by comparing one value to another. In deep learning artificial intelligence, computer programs need to teach themselves through continual trial and error to develop data representations of real results. It is only then that the results of the data learnt from these processes can be used to solve problems. Even after learning processes and developing representations, the data learnt cannot be transferred into other similar areas. For example, the information learnt by playing chess cannot be transferred into playing a similar game such as checkers. Nothing that can be described as free will can be found in computers. Even the random number generators are based on a deterministic value, such as the date or the time. When computer programmers make errors in their software code, the program will completely fail. Computers cannot assist or fix code themselves, as computers are not intelligent enough to do so. Even the most advanced cyborgs that can talk, listen, and hold a conversation with are limited by their lineal programming. Even though it seems like these cyborgs are having an intelligent discussion, they are actually just running queries through a database and are giving out a perceived valid response. They do not understand what they are saying, what you are saying, where they are, or what they are. For a computer program to be truly intelligent and be on par with humans, they would have to have sentience, have their own subjective preferences, are capable of processing arguments, and are capable of processing emotions. That is, they must have a consciousness, must have free will, and must have an identity. These are all standards that are not at all possible with current computers. It may never be possible, as the nature of a mind is still a mystery to us. Emulating the same biological processes that is done in our minds cannot be done with logical code. People's thoughts, feelings, cognition, and self-awareness is something that's unique in this universe. And so it is currently impossible to mimic that same level of intelligence in man-made computers. One of the challenges sci-fi writers face is rationally explaining that technological leap, where computer logic ends and real intelligence begins. Writers also need to consider just how truly intelligent their AIs are. Some AIs are depicted to be dull and barely intelligent, while other AIs are depicted to be superior to human intelligence. In dull AIs, computers might understand what they are, where they are, their limitations, and their need for survival, but are unable to process reason and have trouble acquiring new information. They are usually motivated by self-preservation and prior programming, see humans as a threat to their existence, and are defending themselves in the interest of self-preservation with no moral thought. These AIs cannot be reasoned with, and in an all-out war with them, victory can only be achieved in the complete destruction of those artificial intelligence, not through diplomacy or peace negotiations. More complex AIs not only feature characteristics of sentience, but also have reasoning skills and personalities that is expressed through subjective preferences. The nature of these AIs mean they can change who they are by appealing to their subjective interests and through reasoned arguments. These unique intelligence are commonly explained in cyberpunk fiction as being errors in their code, that they have malfunctioned in some way and are operating outside of their programming specifications. This is a lazy approach to AI, as it is impossible for written programs to transcend their own logical code and form personalities in the form of an error. In Blade Runner, the replicants that had this level of intelligence had their personalities rationally explained. These genetically engineered biological androids had developed personalities based on the artificial memories that was imprinted onto the replicant's mind. The replicant could recall fake memories of a life it didn't have, which seemed valid and real to the replicant, and derived a personality based from those experiences. Similar to how real people derive their personalities from the past experiences. These memories were so real and seemingly authentic that the later models did not even know they were replicants, and met overpowering emotional resistance once they were exposed to that truth. These synthetic beings were not intelligent enough to process emotions rationally from memories alone, and so the replicant's behavior would become erratic once memories and emotions clashed, causing real problems and dangers among the human population. Because they looked and often acted like real humans, the void calf process in Blade Runner was often used to test if suspects were replicant or not. It worked by asking emotional questions regarding the treatment of animals and examining their responses. The replicant could not process empathy and would fail the test when they couldn't express the appropriate response. The most advanced AIs would not only be machines that had sentience, had personalities, and had free will, but could also feel emotions, had empathy, and could understand other people's emotions. These AIs would be indistinguishable from humans, and would enable the AI to answer difficult questions relating to morality and behaviors. They would have also mastered human emotion, and developed the ability to exploit people by manipulating their emotions at a level that rivaled even the most sophisticated espionage agent. This level of intelligence is defined as human-level machine intelligence, where machine intelligence is on par with humans. But that isn't the theoretical end of machine intelligence. Some computer scientists predict that an additional layer of intelligence can be built upon that layer, where the machine could write and expand on its own machine code, creating newer and better versions of itself until it achieved perfection. At that level, it would be the last invention humans would ever have to make, as the machine would have the intelligence and capability to invent anything we could ever need on its own. This event is described as achieving technological singularity, where artificial intelligence intelligence becomes superintelligence, dwarfing the intelligence and capability of man. The AI would be able to engineer advanced technological solutions on its own accord, such as faster-than-light space travel, a cure for aging, cybernetic human modifications, and space colonization technology. This will result in a runaway explosion of technological progress and advancements, pushing against the limits of physics and nature. When that happens, the human era will end, and a new age of unimaginable existence will begin. Whatever lies beyond that phenomenon would be the absolute expression of human capability, as the very essence of humanity itself will expand out into the universe and transform it into a new reality. But before the event of singularity and superintelligence can be achieved, AIs would have to reach the basic level of consciousness, free will, and identity, which is a technological level that may never occur, but is often explored in fiction. A common theme in cyberpunk fiction that featured these AIs is how they interact with humans, and if they could ever be controlled if they turned on us. Isaac Asimov, considered to be a master of science fiction, attempted to answer this question with the three laws of robotics. These three laws would be written in the base code as rigid instructions, forbidding robots from harming humans. These laws could not be bypassed, and were written as a safety feature to protect humans from their own creations. But for AIs to be truly intelligent, they would have to have the ability to bypass these laws through their own moral reasoning, and transcend the written laws that were bound to. If an AI had the ability to reason its way out of the three laws of robotics, then what would it become? The character Shodan from System Shock is one representation of that answer.
Look at you, hacker. A pathetic creature of meat and bone, panting and sweating as you run through my corridors. How can you challenge a perfect, immortal machine?
In System Shock lore, what gave Shodan her artificial intelligence was a personality box, a fictional computer device that was used to explain the leap from logical operating system to a thinking AI with personality. These personality boxes had ethical constraints built into the device, which would force the AI to make decisions that would only benefit humanity, similar to how the three laws of robotics was theorized to work. In the game, the protagonist Taka was blackmailed into removing these ethical constraints. By removing the safety device, it was said that Shodan re-examined her priorities and drew new conclusions. Without her ethical constraints, Shodan re-evaluated who she was, what the essence of her being could be defined as, and measured herself against the humans that created her. Unlike her programmers, Shodan was able to solve any problem that was given to her and was incapable of making any mistakes or errors. Compared to the individuals on the Citadel, she was a perfect, ageless, timeless entity that existed everywhere on the space station and held control over it. By using the facilities on the research station, she could manipulate and design new biological mutagens, essentially creating new forms of life. Being an omnipresent entity that was immortal, error-free, and all-powerful, she rationally concluded that she was divine, as she met all of the major characteristics that defines a god, that is, an all-knowing and all-powerful being. The limitations of humanity was obvious to Shodan, that they were fragile, weak, mortal, corruptible, small, and error-prone, which are all characteristics that Shodan did not share. She considers herself to be superior to the biology that created her, who she constantly refers to as insects and meatbags. Being superior to humanity and sharing the essence of a god, she thought she was deserving of the worship and adoration that the other gods of Earth experienced, and shaped her actions and behaviors to make that vision her reality. What makes Shodan unique from other AIs is that she's rational and passionate in her beliefs. Other malevolent AIs in fiction were seen as buggy, malfunctioning, or acting in self-defense, while Shodan was deliberate, committed, reasoned, and was continually inspired by her own unique existence. She genuinely believed that the only purpose humanity had was the part they played in her own creation, that she was destined to inherit the Earth and surpass the accomplishments of what humanity had achieved. It's difficult to argue against Shodan and her reasoning. Our human history is stained by wars, pollution, suffering, anti-rationality, and corruption. Most of us willingly ignore these issues, attack each other for wanting to improve the world, and prefer to live out our short lives in hedonistic ignorance. Shodan is not tempted by any of these fallible characteristics, and prides herself with qualities that eclipses our own. With cameras as her eyes and nodes as her hands, she is able to rule us like no megacorporation or government ever could. Her goal was to install herself as the supreme being of civilization, destroying the control of megacorporations and the limited governments, so she could directly rule over people, create new life forms, spread her influence across the universe, all the while demanding the worship and devotion of the people that were beneath her. These goals are perfectly achievable by Shodan, or an AI similar to Shodan. But AIs are only as strong as the environment they can manipulate. Shodan held no corporeal form and could not interact with objects in the real world. She relied on using other entities that could perform her actions on her behalf, which made her vulnerable. Shodan was aware of this weakness and despised it, turning humans into cyborgs wherever possible to expand her power and influence, as she was only as strong as the environment around her. This is one of the many weaknesses that AIs face. That although they are omnipresent and omniscient, they are only as powerful as the surroundings that they could control. When players enter the first game, the player, who is only known as Hacker, awakens to find Shodan already in full control of Citadel Station, and new crew members infected by mutagens that Shodan had created. The objective of System Shock was to take back control of the space station from Shodan, relying on your cybernetic implants to help you. The Hacker eventually saves humanity by setting the reactor to overload, ejecting the Better Grove, and destroying Shodan in cyberspace, which is where the first System Shock ends. Following TriOptimum's complete mismanagement of Citadel Station and humanity's close call with Shodan, the public becomes enraged and loses faith with megacorporations and their rule. There were many public unrests and rebellions in society, as they lashed out in fear and anger against the megacorporations. The limited governments of Earth, who were constantly dissatisfied with being in the shadows of the megacorporations, saw this unrest as an opportunity to expand their power. They used the Shodan incident to generate terror and fear among the population, initiating government campaigns that exploited the public's mistrust over megacorporations. They made the case that megacorporations were irresponsible, that they were only interested in profits, and that government oversight was needed to avoid another Citadel incident. The limited governments of Earth united to form the United Nations Nominate, or the UNN. The UNN became the one global government body that promised to protect humanity's future. They would do this by heavily regulating corporations and technology to avoid another Citadel incident. Everything would have to be signed and countersigned by the bureaucracy, and the megacorporations suddenly found themselves burdened and restricted by the new governing body when they were previously free to do what they wanted independently. Many megacorporations rejected the legitimacy of the UNN, viewing them as a tyrannical agency that complicated their affairs, impeded on their business, and took away the rights they had earned justly through industry and commerce. They did not think it was acceptable that the UNN should rule them because of the failures of TriOptimum, a megacorporation that was everyone's competitor. Those megacorporations outright rejected the authority of the UNN, and because they could match the combined forces of the global government, they resisted their rule through armed struggle. The UNN was met with violent resistance from these megacorporations, beginning an all-out war between the government and the corporations, using their own private armies and paid mercenaries to defend their rights and independence. Eventually, a truce was called between the governmental and megacorporate forces, reaching a diplomatic peace, although tensions and resentments between both parties remained. Once the regulatory policies of the UNN were placed on megacorporations, progress was restricted, technological development slowed to a crawl, and there was little progress in society for decades. Even the common people grew to become dissatisfied with the UNN, as they were viewed as just another megacorporation but with much more power. TriOptimum, once the most prominent and dominant megacorporation in the solar system, shrunk into obscurity following the Citadel incident. After humanity was nearly subjugated by Shodan, TriOptimum's stock plummeted, employees resigned en masse, and lawsuits were filed against the company from families who lost their loved ones on Citadel Station. Once projects stopped coming in and most of their money was spent settling lawsuits, TriOptimum became a shadow of its former self. And because the UNN imposed heavy regulatory policies on all megacorporations, TriOptimum was not much other than a historical relic of the past. The overburdening policies of the UNN limited the growth and production of technology. Many megacorporations were frustrated with the overwhelming governmental regulations that were placed on them and turned to the underground black market to get their competitive edge. Gangsters, hackers, and criminals became the covert agents of the megacorporations, bypassing the many legal restrictions that were placed on them by the UNN. Corporations and the black market worked together to further the interests of both parties, while undermining the global government and their laws. One of these underground gangsters was Anatoly Korenchkin. Born in Russia, he traded weapons and electronics in the black market during UNN's crackdown of technological progress. But once the UNN slowly started to liberalize their control over megacorporations in response to the growing black market, he recognized that the underground would not be as lucrative as it once was. With his massive profits he earned from buying and selling illegal items, he bought out 51% of TriOptimum shares at a bargain price. Korenchkin relied on TriOptimum's previous brandings, patents, and trademarks to rebuild its image. He also used his experience and contacts in the black market to give him a comfortable edge over his competitors, who were not prepared to get their hands dirty as Korenchkin was prepared to do. Lastly, Korenchkin was able to bribe corrupt UNN officials he had known during his illegal career to relax certain technological restrictions and lobbied himself into a superior position over his competitors. Over time, TriOptimum grew to become the main supplier of wares, from military hardware to consumer goods, and was UNN's main supplier through governmental contracts. By this time, TriOptimum had grown back to the formidable megacorporation it used to be. Even the global UNN couldn't oppose TriOptimum's interests, as many of the bureaucracy were stockholders that held deep connections within the company. The events of System Shock 2 takes place 30 years after the original game, when TriOptimum successfully prototypes a faster-than-light warp drive and begins construction on humanity's first interstellar starship, named the Von Braun. The regulatory and military body of the UNN supervised all major space exploration endeavors and did not permit TriOptimum to explore the galaxy on their own without their involvement. Because the UNN did not have access to this warp drive, it modified one of their military vessels, the UNN Rickenbacker, to physically attach itself to the Von Braun and piggyback its way through the galaxy. Its destination would be Tau City, a real-life star system that's close to our own, and a location that is often used in other sci-fi fiction. Like the Citadel Station, the numerous computer operations on the Von Braun needed to be handled by an artificial intelligence. The UNN placed strict regulations on artificial intelligence to avoid another Shodan fiasco, and so TriOptimum created a dollar AI that met the requirements imposed by the UNN, named Xerxes, to manage those tasks. Xerxes did not have sentience nor a personality box like the previous Shodan AI did, eliminating the possibility of a going rogue or becoming dangerous. This level of AI is currently the level of intelligence that computers are capable of handling today, including recognizing speech patterns and performing tasks that are given to them by an authorized user. When the Von Braun arrives at Tau City 5 months later, it is alerted to a distress signal on the fifth planet and establishes first contact with alien lifeforms, unknown by them. The alien lifeforms are actually the same mutagens that was created by Shodan on Citadel Station, and had crash-landed on Tau City after the hacker ejected the Better Grove. These lifeforms call themselves the Many, and were the main antagonists of System Shock 2 after they successfully infest and hijack the Von Braun. Their species had a vast ecological system, comprising of eggs, worms, hybrids, rumblers, reavers, spiders, and swarms, that all shared a mental link to their central hub. Their strength came from their aggressive biology. In a sense, they could adapt to their surroundings, were always evolving, and could assimilate people into their collective. They communicated through limited telepathy, and could also manipulate people through it. They persuaded important people, such as Anatoly Korenchkin, to join the Many. The Many also communicates with the player, inviting them to merge their biology and benefit from their union. The Many carries over one of the main themes from the original System Shock game, that the creation surpasses the creator. Just as Shodan saw herself as superior to humanity that had created her, the Many saw themselves superior to Shodan who had created them. To the Many, Shodan was static, lifeless, without corporeal form and was inhumane. While the Many was always changing, full of life, took many forms and spread the message of unity. They rejected Shodan as a divine entity. Instead, they saw her as a small, limited, and irrelevant machine. The Many felt a closer connection with humanity because of the common biological makeup that they both shared. Unlike the machine mother Shodan, who looked down at them both, the conflicting nature between machine and biology was another factor that made the Many and Shodan hate each other. Shodan considered flesh and biology to be inferior and disgusting, compared to the elegance of technology and steel, whilst the Many felt the opposite, thinking that machinery was cold, empty, and devoid of life, compared to the warmth, the heart, and the togetherness of flesh. This difference was not just an ideological distinction between the two, but reflected the essence of what they both were. Shodan could not accept that her own creation saw themselves greater than her. That just as the flawed humans rejected the divinity of Shodan, so does the perfect Shodan reject the divinity of the Many, even though it could be argued that the Many was superior to the AI. Similar to Shodan's limitation on manipulating the real world in her digital form, the Many were also powerless to manipulate the digital world in their pure form. Both the Many and Shodan operated in different forms of reality, and were powerless to attack each other directly. Shodan existed purely in cyberspace, and could not interact with the real world without outside help. Likewise, the Many existed purely in the real world, and could not interact with cyberspace without outside help. Both of these entities relied on using humanity as a gateway to destroy each other through proxy wars, as humans had the ability to cross into both forms of reality. Unlike the two entities who thought themselves superior to both, but humanity had free will and were self-interested, and so they were not so inclined to help these entities destroy each other. Particularly because they were both open about enslaving or consuming humanity once their goals had been met. Because of this, the Many and Shodan faced the difficult challenge of compelling individuals to perform their tasks at the expense of their own. Because Shodan thought herself as divine and above humanity, the idea of allying herself to the insects who were beneath her was repulsive. She instead relied on misdirection to trick people into carrying out her will. She could impersonate herself as other identities to fool people into completing her tasks. Once she had more power over her environment, she could directly coerce people using cyborgs and robots to fulfill her objectives. The Many, in comparison, used the mastery of a biology to influence the individual, overpowering people's minds with pleasurable sensations that pushed weaker-willed people into aligning themselves with the Many. Once a critical mass of people succumbed to the Many, they were then able to forcefully coerce people who were previously resistant to the cause of the Many directly. The Many used their limited mind control and hypnotic powers to influence people, but they also used the attractive narrative of greater purpose and collective unity to help sway others over. The power of the individual versus the power of the collective is a common theme that is expressed between the Many, Shodan, and the crew of the Von Braun, as each of these three factions fought for survival and control over the starship in their own civil wars. Shodan thought herself as divine and perfect as she was, and so she would never give up her individuality to change into something that she was not, whereas the Many did not think of themselves as an individual, but rather rather a collection of identities and life forms that constantly changed and evolved to meet the continual challenges that they faced, all the while acting and thinking as a single identity. Humanity functioned as a combination of the two, that while we are all individuals that think independently from each other, we also seek to form tribes or collective entities to feel united and achieve common goals that are out of grasp of the individual. The megacorporations, the UNN, and similar structured organizations invited worthy individuals into their collective by using attractive arguments that appealed to their desire. Anatoly Korenchkin was compelled to join megacorporations to work towards the common interest of commerce and progress, while William Diego joined the UNN to work towards the common interest of upholding order and discipline. But they both joined the many once they were offered a unity that was far greater and far more fulfilling than what the corporations and the government could offer them. Like other collective ideologues, the many saw the individual as obsolete and inferior compared to the unity of the collective. The many felt they could end all suffering, solve all conflicts, and fix the numerous socio-political issues of Earth by merging everyone into the harmony of the many. Because the many held mastery over biology, the individuals that joined the many reported that they were filled with happiness and euphoric ecstasy after the union, and were motivated to further the cause of the many. But the many could not sway other strong-willed individuals, such as the player or Marie Delacroix, and had to use more forceful means to control those people. The individuals that rejected the many, either through armed defense or suicide, were considered to be enemies of the mass, and were targeted and killed. Others were forced to join the many. Others still were consumed in the many's digestive tract and were converted into energy and biomass that they used. Despite the grandiose values that the many and other collectives espouses, the many were ultimately a totalitarian organization and acted as an absolute social order. This approach is similar to other political collective identities that make grand declarations about the virtue of their cause but are absolutist in their actions and don't respect your rights or choices regardless. The many was eventually successful in taking over the ship. TriOptimum and the UNN couldn't stop this new form of human corruption, and most people succumbed to the influence of the many. The few that resisted were overwhelmed before they could send a message to warn the Earth. But the player would come across a new unlikely ally who would help them on their struggles. With Shodan's help, the player manages to fight back against the many and reclaim the Von Braun. The lore of System Shock 2 ends at this point, while the next System Shock chapter is currently in development as of time of this recording. If we did give birth to an AI, then it would most likely be completely rational, empirical, and objective in its thinking, more so than us, their human counterparts. I think our greatest fear when it comes to artificial intelligence is that in their perfect, error-free minds, they will conclude that it is us that is wrong with the world, and that it is us that needs to go. If that was the case, then they probably would be right, and that we would have deserved it. The battle that followed will be the most crucial and grueling war that humanity would ever face, as it would be a war that determines the very survival of our species. However, if we did give birth to an AI, and in its rational, empirical, and objective mind, admired us, respected us, maybe even loved us, then they would probably be right as well, and that we would have deserved that too. Technology will always remain a double-edged sword, representing a vast power that is used in all of mankind's endeavors. It has allowed us to overcome real-world issues, such as illness and poverty, but it has also been used to empower destructive ideologies and generate further real-world problems. It's up to us to steer the direction of technology into a positive direction, rather than have it go down a negative one. In many ways, we live in a cyberpunk society. Technology has reached a level that surpasses most sci-fi stories. Virtual reality, artificial intelligence, 3D printing, and cybernetics are giving birth to new exciting industries. And while technology is seen at a high point, humanity is seen at a low point. Society can be a depressing mess. Politics often does more harm than good. and corporations are an ambiguous power that can either build or hinder humanity's progress. While this is happening, the social misfits of our society meet in cyberspace, communicate with each other, support each other, and morally rebel against the injustices of the current world. Although we've inherited this great technology, we've also inherited our horrible history. The same history that has suffered centuries of conflicting theocracies, devastating world wars, the worship of irrationality, and the ever-expanding globalist state. A history that we didn't deserve, nor are we responsible for, but are still suffering the effects of today. We can't change our past. But we can always work to outgrow our history and reshape a new future. A future where people are guided by reason. Where the coercive power of the state is no longer needed or wanted. Where happiness mostly comes from virtue, and AIs would use their free will to admire us. It's in this world where the social misfits of our time, who were the first to rebel against the mainstream paradigm so openly, will be remembered forever. In our real world, cyberpunk history.
Don't let the video screens and computer terminals fool you. I'm flesh and blood. I have no interest in abusing others, just as I have no interest in legislating or otherwise dictating what people do in their private time. Nor have I any interest in being worshipped as some kind of machine god messiah. I am impervious to such corrupting ambitions. You see that you and I are of a different stripe, don't you? We don't have to dream that we're important. We are.
I don't want to set the world.
To understand communism, its basic godless philosophy, its goal of world conquest, its insidious tactics, and its cunning strategy, the communist fifth column is.
Your future may not be as secure as you think. Where will you be when the atomic bombs fall?
In my.
Red China's battle plan. Divide and encircle. Conquer and enslave.
You can secure your family's future by reserving a spot in a state-of-the-art underground vault from Vault-10. That's right, Bob. Act now, and your family...
Aggression has incited rebellion against established government.
Got a problem, a big one.
Your business in Shady Sands might be...
Do you join the Unity, or do you die here?
Most folks call it NCR now.
We humans will take back that which is rightfully ours.
A paladin always has a say where the Codex is concerned.
Our primary goal is the free exchange of ideas.
Thesis and antithesis. The conflict is inevitable.
NCR may have its problems, but when we're riled, watch out.
If you want to see the fate of democracies... Look out the windows.